In the field of psychology, there are many subspecialties that somebody can go into. One of those is biological psychology, and that really is the focus of how biological systems interact with an individual's behavior and cognitive functioning and performance in their day-to-day life. Some of those might include physiology, the way an individual's hormonal makeup is, their genetic makeup, different things all the way down to the level of the brain. So within the field of neuropsychology, there are also subspecialties. It kind of keeps breaking down. In my job at OHSU, I work both clinically and in research. As a clinician, I'm a pediatric neuropsychologist, and I see kids ranging in age from early childhood, age 4, 5, 6, all the way up into early adulthood. My main role is to do neuropsychological assessments of children that have a variety of different neurological types of issues. So that can be anything from traumatic brain injury to epilepsy, all the way down to learning disabilities and ADHD. In the last 15 years, there have been many, many technological advances that have helped the field of biological psychology and neuroscience in general. So one of those techniques is the field of neuroimaging, which has exploded over the past 15 years, allowing us for the first time ever to really be able to look into the brains of healthy young individuals and see what's happening at a functional level, a structural level, and even a microstructural level. So the majority of my time is spent running the developmental brain imaging laboratory at OHSU. The reason that I chose the work that I'm doing and what excites me the most about it is really the ability to potentially identify risk features in the brain well before an individual has to experience adverse consequences later in life. So being able to look at these young children and say, you're at risk and maybe we can do something that would prevent you from ever going on to develop depression or ever going on to have a substance use disorder. So because the adolescent brain is so actively developing, that makes it really vulnerable to a host of different things. One of those things is adolescent substance use. Most commonly used during adolescence are alcohol and marijuana, and both of those things have been shown to impact the adolescent brain differently than other stages of development. So one of the things that we study in adolescence is the emergence of different types of substance use disorders. Most of the time you don't think of use disorders as common in adolescence. One of the things we do see with a high level of regularity is binge drinking. So when an individual goes out and consumes 4 or more beverages in an evening, and we have shown that that is actually neurotoxic to the developing adolescent brain. We can see changes in the brain that occur as a result of that drinking when there were no differences in the brain before. The benefit of longitudinal studies really allows us to disentangle some of those chicken or the egg type of questions. So some of the studies that I've been involved in have looked at marijuana use and how it affects adolescent behavior and cognition. We have adolescents maintain abstinence for 30 days by routinely checking their levels of use. And even after 30 days of use in heavy using marijuana users, we tend to see decrements in attention and what we call executive skills, problem solving, planning, those sorts of things that are really, really necessary for adolescents to function in their day-to-day environment. So in my research, one of the major contributions that we have made is identifying some of the neurobiological features associated with a family history of alcoholism. So we know that a family history of alcoholism increases an individual's risk for going on to develop an alcohol use disorder themselves. For the first time really ever, we've been able to identify replicable features in the brains of individuals who have that risk feature but have never used alcohol themselves. So if we know that an individual is at risk based on a certain characteristic in their brain, and we can identify treatment strategies that target that characteristic, again, that will prevent some of the mental illness from ever occurring in our society. All of this holds implications for improving outcomes related to human disease and overall quality of life. So it takes quite a bit of training to become a neuropsychologist. I have a PhD in clinical psychology at a program where there was emphasis specifically in biological psychology and neuropsychology. After that training in graduate school, in order to be clinically trained, one goes on to do an internship and then at least a couple of years of postdoctoral training. So in sum, it's probably about 8 years total of training that got me to where I am. Once you're in the field of neuropsychology, a research career is also very competitive. So day to day, you're working on grants and trying to fund the work that you're doing, as well as writing manuscripts and trying to publish the work that you've conducted. So I chose this career field because I find, again, the brain extremely fascinating. I think that the ability to be able to create your own research questions and pursue them in a way that is interesting to you and that you find novel and exciting is hard to find in any other career. I love what I do. The ability to balance clinical work and research, in my opinion, is the best of both worlds. Not only does my work with patients really inform how I think about research questions, but the research really gives me some backbone to talk with adolescents and their families about what might be happening in their brains and how that affects their day-to-day behavior. Thank you.